Hi, and welcome to Talking Tech. I'm your host, Alejandro Hoyos, and today we're going to be talking about the efficiency course in Lunar Lake, codenamed Skymont. Today we have Steven with us, and he's going to tell us about all the different changes that have been done to the architecture. Hey, Steven, how's it going today?
Good, how are you doing?
Doing well. Thanks for being here with us today.
Of course.
Let's start a little bit with history about the efficiency course. When did we start it? What was the first efficiency core that we worked with here at Intel?
So the first time we took an efficiency core and created hybrid was in Alder Lake. There we started with Crestmont. We combined it with Golden Cove, and we produced a hybrid product called Alder Lake. We had E-cores before that that tended to live in their own product lines, but hybrid was really the place where we brought E-cores to the market.
And then from Alder Lake, we had Raptor Lake, and then Raptor Lake, we had Meteor Lake, which is a little bit different. How is it different from the previous ones?
Yeah, so Meteor Lake was really interesting. It's a product we took and we did disaggregation. So we took multiple dies and we connected them together to make a product. So in there, we had an opportunity to create two different forms of E-core in the same system. So we had an E-core that we put on the ring, on the fabric that we typically use in clients. We also added what we called LP E-cores, or low power E-cores. Those were separate from the ring. They were put into the SoC itself, near the system agent, near memory. And there, we could enable those cores, we could run them without the expense of running all of the other high compute infrastructure. So as a result, we could run certain workloads on those smaller cores and get some nice battery life savings.
So was that a refer as the low power island? Is that kind of what we know as a low power island?
Yeah. So you know, what do you call the thing that's different from what you keep doing? So
right.
the term we came up with was low power island. So the idea here is that it's isolated. You know, it's kind of separate from the continent. You know, everybody likes islands; they're fun. But you can go there, and it's just less expensive to turn on. Right, since it's a smaller infrastructure, you turn on your memory controller, you turn on the cores, you turn on the cache, and that's it. And so that's one of the fundamental things that brings low power, is that there's not as much going on when they're active as when the full system is going.
That makes sense. And for Lunar Lake, we also have low power island, but it's probably defined differently.
Yeah, absolutely. So in Meteor Lake, we started. And you know, we made a few trade-offs. We focused on cost, and that was great. In Lunar Lake, we really took it to the next level. So Meteor Lake didn't have what we call a system cache or memory side cache, and we brought one of those into Lunar Lake. So now, instead of having cores that didn't really have a cache or a large cache keeping them from memory, you now have a cache that is larger. With that larger cache, you spend less time in memory, your latency is down, your energy efficiency goes up, and your performance goes up. So that's step one, is the change to the fabric, so that now we have better bandwidth and lower latency. The other thing we did is we moved from a Crestmont low power core to a Skymont low power module. So now on Crestmont, we had two cores. We had a 2 megabyte L2. Mm-hmm. And with Skymont, we have a new microarchitecture. We made enhancements to power and performance, and we have four of them, and we have a 4 meg L2. So the net combination of those is suddenly not only is power better, but there's so many more workloads you can run on this low power island that it's really a game changer when it comes to battery life, power efficiency, and usability.
No, that makes completely sense. And for Meteor Lake, we had the low power islands, and we had some specific workloads that we could execute. But now for Lunar Lake, I guess now with all these different changes, would you guys want to like expand the amount of workloads that can be done?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, if you're doing, say, video playback, I'm playing Netflix or YouTube, something like that, those low power cores had enough performance that they could sustain the majority of the workload and get that power savings. But if you're running something like Teams, which is a modern workload that everybody runs, right, ever since the pandemic, well, Teams requires a bit more CPU power. So because of that, on Meteor Lake, it would end up using the compute die, it might use E-cores, it might use P-cores. Here in Lunar Lake, with the low power island, with the thread director enhancements that we've made, now Teams is reliably running on that E-core cluster. So now power is down, performance is great, and it's extended battery life. So that's an example of additional workload coverage that we can now run on those cores.
No, that's great. And for that workload, I mean, you have all these changes, but you also make some changes to the microarchitecture itself.
Absolutely, yes. So if we had taken, just say, the Crestmont, and we had put four of those instead of two, and we had used a larger L2, and we'd add the system cache, we would have gotten some of the benefit because, you know, those fabric changes were great. But that wasn't enough. So we took the microarchitecture and changed it, almost every part of it. So it's wider, it's deeper. It's about a 50% bigger machine, and it's got about twice the vector throughput and AI throughput as Crestmont did. And those changes alone, you take an improvement, and then you compound it again with an advanced microarchitecture, and now you can really start running more workloads.
For the microarchitecture, when I was looking at it, I saw something that a lot of the stuff really jumped on me, but there was one thing that really caught my attention, and which was you have this 3x3 cluster.
Yeah.
So that's a 3x3 decode cluster. Can you tell us a little bit more about that and how it goes through the whole pipeline?
Yeah, absolutely. So, one of the things that the rest of the industry worries about is taking x86, variable length decode, and scaling it out to high performance and efficiency. So a couple generations ago, we figured out that we could take a basic 3Y decoder, which people have been building for a long time, and we can start arraying out multiples. We call them clusters. So in, say, Gracemont in Alder Lake, we had two 3Y clusters. Our peak throughput is 6Y. Well, we've gotten good at building that, and so now this was the generation we chose to make a third cluster. So now, instead of being able to be peak 6Y, now we can decode up to 9 instructions per cycle with our 3x3 decoder. So that's incredible. But the best part is, it's not terribly expensive, right? Is that because it's done in this clustered way, we're not paying this kind of exponential that people think that you might pay because of variable length decode. So with the cluster decode, we've shown that we could scale to 6, now we've shown that we can scale to 9 in a nice, tight, efficient way.
Yeah, that was pretty impressive. And in order, now that we have this 3x3 cluster, you have to feed it, right? So there was also some changes, I guess, down to the previous blocks in the pipeline.
Yeah. So all modern microarchitectures start with prediction. So, where are we going? What's the next instruction? Google or any map-based instructions, it tells you, I'm turning a 500 yards, turn in 1,000 yards. So in Skymont, we basically get the instructions a little quicker. So it's sort of like, instead of turning 50 yards, now we know 250 yards when to turn. So this is a 128-byte prediction. So we look across 128 bytes, two full cache lines, just to find that next turn. Because when we find the next turn, we can start the next cluster up, and we can start the parallel decode up, and in general, again, bring more bandwidth to the front end to feed that 3x3 cluster, and then send those instructions on to the rest of the machine.
You were talking about vector performance and also AI throughput. How about we start a little bit more on the changes that help us with vector performance?
Sure. So typically, or historically, we have done 2 128-bit vector pipelines for floating point operations. We have a third one for integer moves and things. The industry is valuing vector performance more and more, and values AI performance more and more. So when we started Skymont, we said, look, if we want to be a modern microprocessor and run modern workloads, we need to spend more on the vector performance. Everybody says you're an E-core, it's just not that important. But it was so important to us to be able to run a variety of workloads, just to make sure anything works well, that we went ahead and bit the bullet, and we spent a lot more on vector. So now we have 4 parallel FMAs, FADs, and execution units that do things like VNNI. Intel is one of its integer instruction set additions. So our peak throughput can be 2x what it was in the previous generation. And again, that's key so that low power island can run, almost any workload.
What were the changes that we made to support the wider vector?
Yeah, so now that we have more vector throughput, it's kind of a hungrier machine. So in order to feed that hungrier machine, we made 2 or 3 other changes. So one example is we went from 2 loads per cycle to 3. So now we have 50% more L1 load bandwidth. That's important to feed those vector units. The other two things is we changed the entire width of the machine. So in Gracemont, we were 5-wide allocation. So we can allocate 5 instructions or UOPs into the back end of the machine per cycle. When we went to Crestmont, it's 6-wide. And now in Skymont, we went ahead to 8-wide. I've got a 9-wide front end to decode. Now I've got 8-wide allocation. And then we have 16 wide retire to go along with that. And then we made the out of order window about 50, 60% larger. So all of that is good for general performance and specifically to feed those hungrier vector units.
Oh, that's great. When we're talking about AI and how this has become more important day in day, in your opinion, like for a, what workloads would be good for a CPU, either like latency related or what type of workloads you think they should be dedicated?
Yeah, no, great question. You know, everyone's doing AI these days and everyone has an opinion on where it should be done and how it should be done. AI seems to be, for me as a CPU designer, as a CPU architect, the thing I can bring to AI is two things. One is support for enhanced data types, right? So, you know, everyone's still arguing, is it FP64, is it FP32, is it FP16, 8.4, you know, you can keep going. And then there's the integer, right? So VNNI is an example of an integer ISA. So we want to support those data types. You also have, you know, FP16 for a memory image, to FP32 load. So first, a CPU is where so much of the development is done before it's packaged up so it can run on different machine. So it's important to make sure you support the data types. And once you support the data types, then what forms of machine learning tends to run on a CPU? Well, if you don't want to package it up, you don't want the software development, you don't want to have to offload it, you can still run it on the CPU. So if latency is critical, if software enabling is critical, the CPU can be a really nice place to run AI.
Oh, that's pretty impressive. And I think that you guys took in mind when you were designing the E-cores was the scalability. So being able to grab this design and maybe put it somewhere else. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so most of the conversation we've been having is about the low power island and, mm-hmm. and Skymont and a 4-core module and a 4-megal tube. You know, it's the same as in Crestmont and Meteor Lake and in Alder Lake and Raptor Lake. We can take that same IP and take it off that low power island and put it back onto a ring, onto a high performance client fabric. So we still have that capability with Skymont. And you know, Intel will release products where that is the use for this IP. So when you do that, you get that same, you know, MT scalability, right? So in say Raptor Lake, for example, we had 8 P cores and we ended up with 16 E cores. Mm-hmm. So you still have that option here to build that out with Skymont. You know, we can connect to the fabrics, we can consume the bandwidth, and they're still, you know, have that same efficient mark. And you get all the IPC and performance along with that as well.
So for the first iteration of the efficiency cores, we use Skylake kind of as the standard of what we want to do the performance to be. How has that evolved throughout the latest iterations of the E core and the architecture?
Right, so you know, the rest of the industry has talked about hybrid, they've got different names for it. They tend to think of this as really, really small cores that you know you can use. At Intel, we've taken a different perspective, right? We don't want those small cores to be ineffective, right? So in Alder Lake, right, we disclose that, hey, the IPC of this machine is similar to Skylake, but much lower power and area. So in this generation, we still think that's the right attitude. We still think that's the right approach. So this generation, what we've chosen to do is demonstrate that the IPC of Skylake compares quite favorably to today's Raptor Cove shipping in today's Raptor Lake product. So this isn't a comparison against products we haven't sold for a couple of years. This is, you know, the direct comparison IPC, you know, that's the kind of core you can get with our efficient cores.
So if you attach Skymont to an LLC ring and compare it to Raptor Lake, we'll see that that's kind of the performance that we get.
That's right. So, you know, there's an S curve. Some workloads were a little better, some workloads were a little worse, but, you know, taken as a whole, the Skymont are slightly faster. They have a slightly higher IPC. You know, Raptor Cove, Raptor Lake, you know, it's a 6+ gigahertz core.
Right.
That's not where we're trying to go. So it's still fantastic for that. But, you know, in the context of an E core, that IPC, it really hits that mark.
Steven, I learned a lot. Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Yeah, it's
Thank
great talking to you.
Thank you too.